new best friend in Santa Fe, I guess. And the other thing is, I get to meet some of the most interesting, curious human beings I've ever met in my life. Because Rose Scholar participants tend to be people who are curious about the world.
I'm Sandy Lieberman. I'm also from outside of Atlantic City. And after walking around here for 2 days, Santa Fe is a town with very beautiful and very expensive stuff to buy.
That totally changed everything for the people, particularly the people who would eventually be known as the Pueblo Indians.
It was a dollar movie theater, and showing old movies. And they eventually closed down. A local nonprofit group formed, the foundation formed, to buy it, and it's now a performing arts center. But the style of architecture, see, this was built in the 1930s, just has a Moorish influence to it. And you know, it's not part of the style. But the Museum of New Mexico created a program that allows Native American artists to form a co-op that would allow them to sell where they're selling right now. What we call the portal, everybody else calls it a port. Now, I don't take people in there, but it's a very beautiful church inside. But if you go there, look at the keystone above the archway. And in that keystone, you will find, in Hebrew, Yahweh. And a thank you to the Jewish community in New Mexico. Now, those people came into New Mexico during the early territorial period after the
having done it twice, and you know, I don't know, my brain is getting soft or something. Anyway, so, once we're done, the O'Keeffe Museum, you're on your own for the whole day, except been a docent at the O'Keeffe Museum since they opened, right?
Right.
So, and that's been how many years now? 15?
21.
21, wow.
But I grew up in Los Angeles, went to public schools, and ended up at UC Davis, University of California, Davis, studied veterinary medicine. And Mark and I tried to clean it off, and it won't clean off. So we're going to see, you'll see stars up there in the images. So I apologize for that. But most people think of O'Keeffe. And O'Keeffe, if you know anything about art history, was born in 1887 in Sun Prairie, Wisconsin. Dies in 1986 here in Santa Fe. She's 98 and a half. And dies at St. Vincent's Hospital. But doesn't really start coming to New Mexico to paint till 1929. She would come and spend the summers here. Photographers that came to New Mexico: John Sloan, Robert Henright, George Bellows, Edward Hopper, Stuart Davis, Marsden Hartman, John Marin. Photographers: Ansel Adams, Edward Weston, Dorothea Lang, Paul came to New Mexico, spent time out here. By the way, did you, any of you, I know you were intent on looking at your food as you were going through the buffet line, but did you see the three photographs that are right over the food there? Who took those photographs? Those are Ansel Adams' photographs. But I was watching, just to give you an idea how flat it is, I was watching PBS and there was a rancher on and he was from the Amarillo area and he said, you know, it's so flat out here. He said that last week when his dog ran away from the ranch, he said he could watch him leave for 3 days. So that's pretty flat. What's going on there? There's Mother Earth. There's her belly button, right? She's been devastated by the plow and created this horrific dust bowl. So a little more graphic, but he's anthropomorphized and introduced that into the landscape.
That's a photograph.
That's a photograph.
Nice storm.
Nice storm. Thank you. We're going to get this fixed.
20-25 minute ride to get out to El Dorado, where Red Mesa is located. So there was a giant who was harassing our people. We couldn't do anything about it. This giant was so powerful that there was nothing that we could do. But the warrior twins came to our rescue. Now these are all spirit figures now, but the warrior twins came to our rescue. And the warrior twins fought the giant and killed the giant. And his blood filled this valley. And what you call lava, we call the blood of the giant. That's how we know. Now how are you gonna argue that?
Yes.
We have our stories, right? And to somebody that's never heard our stories, when they hear our stories, they might say, 7 days? That 7 days? Come on, right? In the Pueblo culture, the grandmothers are the ultimate authority. And so finally he raised his hand up and he said, excuse me, so are you telling all these people here that men cannot own anything here? She said, oh, no, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is, if a man can give birth, yes, they can own something.
So we're going to start right here with the grinding stones. I want to say welcome. My name is Lois Ellen Frank and this is my home. So welcome. And what we have here are some very, very, very old grinding stones. Some go back as old as 500 years. This is the newest. This is from 1997. I brought this up from Mexico because I thought it was really interesting to see a modern version and then some of the very older ones. Whole corn kernels and grind them into the fine powder that we use for the bread, and they get a half a cup. Survive, and if you look closely, it does have prickers. Many desert plants have prickers in true desert fashion. That's the way the plant's saying, leave me alone. It produces red berries. The red berries are very much like a tomatillo, and very high in vitamin C.
Your dinner tonight, we have Walter Whitewater, who's from the Navajo Nation.
Walter,
that we're using today is hand harvested by a husband and wife team. They're the only couple that I know of in this area that are still harvesting the tea in the wild. And so I support them. My background is I'm classically trained as a chef, so equal to our European counterparts. I did learn a very European way of being a chef. We actually follow what's called the brigade system. Corn soup, no dairy. It's gonna be garnished with a roasted red bell pepper and a chipotle chili mixed with white beans. So we're bringing in the corn and the beans. Next, we're going to go into a locally raised bison stuffed inside a very mild New Mexico chili. That's going to be served with herb roasted potatoes and some tomato because the English outlawed dancing for the Irish. And the only way they could dance, because the windows are about chest high, was to cross their arms, and it looked like they weren't dancing, and then they could move their legs. One green chili, if you can eat your whole green chili, has the equivalent in vitamin C of 6 oranges. Wow. It also has medicine, which affects the body. So as you eat the chili, your heart rate increases, and you may feel little beads of perspiration, usually on your forehead, and you may start to feel warm. Okay? That's trigger number one. Trigger number two is, I feel so good. My mouth's on fire, but I'm shoveling in the salsa at the bar because I feel so good. What's happening? The brain is releasing an endorphin in the body, and you're in an endorphin high. Chilies do only what chocolate, exercise, and sex do, so enjoy the journey.
Go, everybody, wave. There we go. I'm going to catch you if you're not waving.
And surprisingly enough, it looks like...
And we're going to be, as we make our way north, we're going to be also going to be driving through several Buffalo reservations in the region north of Santa Fe. So, right in front of us over here where the flags are, over there, that's where we'll meet our guide. It's counterintuitive to me because my understanding was always that, well, you get a much better understanding of your history if somebody writes it down and the next generation can pick up that piece of paper and read it. But according to these linguists, you know, it was at the very least, as accurate as the stories of the history stories are now told.
Today we do still use these for our feast days and our funerals.
Often referred to as the emergence story, because all things living emerge from under the earth. And once they emerge, then they move in the four directions. Okay, so the four directions are a very, very significant part of that creation story. It's difficult for a coyote to get over them because there's nothing to get, there's no grip for them to get on from. Now when you see the photographs from, say, the 19th century of coyote fences, they're not nearly as attractive and nice because they were more functional.
about Millicent, or have you had kind of an overview about her yet?
No.
Okay, so Millicent Rogers, her portrait, her portrait is right here in the brochure that you're holding. She was the granddaughter of Henry Huddleston Rogers, who was a partner with Rockefeller in Standard Oil.
Wow.
So she had the means to collect, and I say she had the means to do just about anything that she wanted to.
The collections here at the Indian Arts Research Center. As you can see, there are two vaults on either side of the room. This is where our collections are stored, and this is where you'll be taking a tour this morning. Research Center and our collections are designed for accessibility, so there is no glass, nothing like that. Everything is entirely out in the open. All the pots and baskets and other items you'll see out on the shelves all around you.
Immersive experience. We encourage our guests to interact, which means touch everything. Yes. Now, remember, you...
And, you know, the people that put this thing together, you know, they're all in, like, in their 20s and 30s anyway,
sure.
So that's a clue right there. So. You know, we've been, since the state doesn't seem to be wanting to negotiate this thing in good faith, and we need a way to increase revenue for the tribe, we've decided to put toll booths on this highway. So this is the highway we're talking about right here. And we're coming up to we're in Pawaukee Pueblo land now, but this is a place of pilgrimage, as we talked about earlier this week. It's also known as a place of healing. It's sometimes referred to as the Lords of America.
But you know, if you look at it, you pay attention to the towers, the windows in the towers, you'll notice that one is a little bit higher than the other one. The windows in one tower are a little bit higher than the other one, and the window in the other one.
Been weaving since 1965, professionally since 1982. We opened the shop in 1982 with my father and Lisa and I, and it was a garage. The next building over there was a garage. The styles have evolved here in New Mexico since then. Most of the early pieces are utility pieces, so they didn't really... Okay, what she's doing now is shuttle work, so basically she's throwing the shuttle that has the yarn across, and you can see how fast she puts it across. He was the one that did all of that design work. That's the type, it's kind of the type of thing that he did. He did a lot of work in textiles. He was also a collector of folk art. And at some point in time, he had this collection of folk art, which he figured out, needed to figure out what he was going to do with. And so he came to the museum and said, would you like my collection?
Opened in 1953 by the woman whose picture you see here, Florence Deville Bartlett. Well, in 1978 he gave us over 100,000 pieces of folk art. Not to worry, you're only going to see 10% of it. I like to think that Mr. Girard started collecting when he was only 6 years old, and a grandfather gave him a nativity set to repair. So there are three things he especially liked to collect, and that was toys, miniatures, and nativity scenes. This corner is primarily India, but up above we have carved wooden toys from India, painted, gessoed, and lacquered.
The worst thing in the world is having a bus driver that doesn't know where to go. And believe me, I've had a couple of those in my lifetime.
restaurants were great, except there was only one restaurant that was too noisy for me to hear what's going on. I don't remember which one.
My gross dollars. You take us to places that we wouldn't have found otherwise. And one of the places on this trip was the research.
Yes,
center.
Yes.
And she, yes, and she was just such a wonderful. Yes. She gave such a wonderful lecture, and she hit the pottery, the textiles, basketry, and I thought that was just wonderful. I loved that.
Nobody had a serious mishap.
Yay!
By the wealth of knowledge from you especially,
yeah,
and Jerry, but especially on George O'Keefe, and even Tim, and every guide, and every docent, and everything. I just, and none of you used cue cards. You didn't look at your notes. I mean, the things that you told us when we were moving on the bus, and about, oh, yeah, over there, and the knowledge that you guys all have was just incredible.
And we thank you for being willing to share it with us.
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
Come on up here to the front.
Okay.
If we have a few people that can kneel, there you go.
It is. Make this quick, Charles. I can't stay down here.
Everybody get on the camera. If you can't see the camera, it can't see you. All right. It's videoing right now.
Now a few people that can kneel, there you go.
It is. Make this quick, Charles. I can't stay down here.
Everybody wave. All right. Not as good as the other one.